Thank you very much. What do I press here? I'll find out as we go along. I'm the warm-up act for Sue and Stuart. Any one of those, okay. Delighted to be here, like Sarah, delighted to be here. It was a privilege to serve on the forestry panel, especially because the estate I'm involved in has such strong connections with forestry. Lord Clinton's great-grandfather was an instigator and founder of the Forestry Commission and its second chairman. He was passionate, forthright and focused. On the day the Forestry Commission was formed, he raced Lord Lovat back to their estates to plant the first tree and was successful. I think he cheated. He had a forester ready at Torrington Station with all he required, went up and that small plantation, I think it's, is it Forestry Commission or is it ours still? Forestry Commission. So he's a very competitive chap. And when I was digging in the archives of the estate, I found he had a mission statement when they formed the Forestry Commission in 29th of November 1919. It was a very clear one. Create the forest that would serve the nation's needs in a future emergency. Very single issue. The government was engaged. It had a large amount of money. So forestry was seen as a strategic asset worthy of parliamentary time. If you read Hansard, there was no messing around. It was about audacious targets. Everyone had to be engaged, huge numbers of jobs and new industries were created. There were a few voices of dissent from the Lake District. So, the independent panel report on forestry, I hope you've all read it. It was not boring on the panel. We had 12 strong independent views. Having a bishop as a chair, especially a bishop from Liverpool where there aren't many trees, was a masterstroke. There were lots of external views about the panel. One that ranged that we were the stooge of government to a very polarised environmental versus industry lobby. Some tough sessions, if I'm not mistaken, but a lot of reflection and much consensus. And the need for a woodland culture for the 21st century was a prime example of that. My view is that forestry is England's best kept secret. Forestry and woods are taken for granted. In many ways, since 1919, I have every respect from the Forestry Commission members in the audience and the Commission itself, but the survival of the Forestry Commission in my twisted mind is probably partly as a result of the mystery of the benefits of forestry within government. And there's a real lack of understanding of the reality and opportunity. There's no real woodland culture in society at large. That's my personal view. Please don't report that as a forestry panel view. But the independent panel on forestry was set this objective as number one on our terms of reference. We had a second objective, which is to look at forestry policy and the Forestry Commission. It's already been mentioned about the timeline. I think the second point down is intriguing, 42,000 responses from the public. So like some of the questions earlier, I'm intrigued to know who the other people were trying to find out and where they are. We did have a huge response. We were kept on our toes. I even joined Twitter so I could find out what on earth was happening. Also actually follow my fellow panel members, what they were up to in their spare time. All of us were very aware of the level of public interest, and all of us now are very aware of the need to maintain momentum and see some action. So the title of the talk was Bringing Back a Wood Culture, and my sort of pushback a bit on that, because I was given the title of the talk by Stuart, or are we facilitating a new one? Is it one culture or many? Personally, in my journey on the forestry panel, which was like an MBA in forestry, and those that know me will know that my knowledge of forestry was somewhat constrained. I was very fortunate to have some highly qualified people in the estate who helped me. So I'm now fully trained with an MBA in forestry, or the equivalent. But during that process, I identified three perceptions of culture, and these are my personal views. So there's a group of people who love England's woods for the reasons that go well beyond financial. As Bishop James says in the introduction to the Forestry Panel report, nature's playground for the adventurous, museum for the curious, hospital for the stressed, cathedral for the spiritual. Very much we engaged with that group of people. and not just in the Forest of Dean. Strongly linked with communities and local livelihoods based on non-timber incomes, nature and tranquility before profit. Now I come to this audience, a perception that Clinton Devon Estates and many in this room fall victim to. Those who see forestry as purely a commercial operation, always seeking financial sustainability as underpinning the management model, heaven forbid. Practical culture rather than the spiritual, professional yet maybe not inclusive, many with generational perspectives, some with not so many. Thirdly, the vast majority of the general public who take it for granted, more about rights and over ownership, access and policy, mainly in a national context. The result is, the result probably, of the fact that forestry is England's best kept secret. So the panel boiled it down to four different agendas: public access, biodiversity, the economics of the timber industry, and the social implications. Social implications for those who rely on industry or forests for a livelihood. We started on the panel with each of those we looked at from a silo perspective. And at first sight, there was a lot of tension. But hasn't there always been a lot of tension? In the past, though, I think, and you reference back to Lord Clinton, 21st Baron Clinton, and the Forestry Commission's objective in those days, which was a very single issue. But there's been a main purpose in the past, be it hunting, be it producing ships, be it pit props, wood for trenches, or a strategic supply for the unknown. Now I believe we are seeking an understanding of the multiple benefits of forestry. We want to think and behave differently. We want to see a new woodland culture in which woodlands and wood as a material and fuel are highly valued and sought after. During our journey on the forestry panel, we came up with something that was termed the triple bottom line. Woods and trees, good for people, good for nature, and good for the green economy. We can't just say we want a woodland culture, though. We need to find some levers to enable one. 82% of woodlands lay outside the public estate. Where do we find the champions and the advocates of woods and forestry? Is it the public sector or is it the private sector, picking up on some of the points that Sarah was making? On the panel, we focused quite a lot on forest services and the need to enhance that particular role and that particular body in terms of expertise and advice. I'll just thought I'd mention it again while I was here. But I believe that industry itself has a huge role, an equally big role, in driving the culture change. The key is how we value our woodlands. And one way of valuing them is looking at existing benefits from woodlands that are not currently bought and sold. Much is made of the non-timber benefits. Ecosystem services is a snappy title for something woodland managers have been delivering quietly for little recompense for over hundreds of years. The government now has established natural capital committees, ecosystem services, market task forces, a whole range of other bodies of highly intelligent people who are trying to work it all out. In my simple Devon approach to all this from Clinton Devon Estates is woods are the ultimate case study. Stop fanning around and get and focus on woodlands, because at the end of the day, that's where you'll get some major wins. It's a huge opportunity to testbed a new market for non-timber benefits. And we should ensure the wood and forest industry in England is at the centre of that. Secondly, increasing active management in the private sector. 40% plus of private woodlands are not managed actively for timber. They're probably managed for shooting, but not actually for timber production. Again, a huge opportunity to connect locally by incentivising the installation of wood boilers, supply chains, increasing income, more thinning, better wildlife, and access, and increasing local community awareness of the commercial roles of woodlands and the constraints that they have. Which leads us to telling the story. We should be engaged with schools, academic institutions and consumers in a way we've never done before, getting the key messages heard. And linked to that, and it was touched on by a question earlier on, raising the profile and importance of forestry careers. Careers in forestry shouldn't be secret. They should be high up young people's agendas. They are the careers that should provide fulfillment and reward in spades, if we really believe in what was written in the Forestry Panel report. My team went out to Germany last year to visit Count Westphalen's estate and met her doctor, Forrester. He's an extremely smart outfit with his horn buttons and his hat with a feather in it, and with his PhD. And they're all over the place. And that person's role in the community was huge and respected. And although I know John Wilding, as head of forestry in Clinton, Devon State, probably wouldn't be seen dead dressed like that in Newton Poppleford in Devon, it does say something of the change that maybe we need to move towards in terms of the relationship between the industry and careers in forestry and what we have today. So the definition that the Forestry Panel came up with for a woodland culture for the 21st century is there. Woodland owners will understand the benefits of managing their woodlands and will be motivated to do so. People will understand the value and value the changing characteristics of productive woodlands. Wood will become the product of choice for people and business, more jobs, better skills, and more timber to market. And for those of you who've got the report in front of you, turn to page 17, and there it all is. And I won't attempt to read it out, but that is our perception of woodland culture in a PowerPoint slide. The recommendation, the main recommendation, was that we urge society as a whole to value woodlands for the full range of benefits they bring. We call on government to pioneer a new approach to valuing and rewarding the management, improvement and expansion of woodland ecosystems for all the benefits they provide to people, nature and the green economy. And that's really where I should stop. But just one more thing, a question. Does anybody recognise this important species of tree? I believe it is impervious to Phytophthora ramorum and a whole range of other diseases which are spreading across the country.
It's a truffle tree.
It's a truffle tree, exactly. And, of course, Dr. Zeus in 1971 wrote The Lorax, which at the time was quite a controversial publication, a children's story and a film now. And the logging industry in North America got quite exercised by some of the things that Dr. Zeus actually said. But when you actually explore the story about the truffle trees being cut down by the Wansler to nip thieves, he was a totally single-minded operation in pursuit of commercial gain with no perception of any damage or impact on anything else. In the end, those who've read the story will recognize or remember there were no trees left. There was something called the Lorax, though. An individual who spoke for the trees because the trees couldn't speak for themselves. With no trees, no environment, there was no wildlife, and interestingly enough, there were no jobs. Because the Wansler brought all his family from all over the country, if you remember, to do all this work, and brought other people. And at the end of the story, they're all walking away disconsolate because they had no jobs to do. So there was no triple bottom line. There was a need to value woods and trees. And the Lorax, I believe, was not against chopping trees down, but was really for sustainable development. So, in the view, my view is really where we go now, it's all in our hands. And it's highly probable that we need to find the Lorax somewhere in government or somewhere in industry to actually lead us forward for a 21st century woodland culture. Thank you very much.